with the flavor of insolence and the forced simplicity of its tone. On both sides of the deck, subdued titters were heard.
"That'll do. Go over," growled Mr. Baker, fixing the new hand with steady blue eyes. And Donkin vanished suddenly out of the light into the dark group of mustered men, to be slapped on the back and to hear flattering whispers. "He ain't afeard. He'll give sport to 'em, see if he don't. Reg'lar Punch and Judy show. Did you see the mate started him? Well, damn, if I ever." The last man had gone over, and there was a moment of silence while the mate peered at his list. 16, 17, he muttered. "I am one hand short, bo'sun," he said aloud. The big West countryman at his elbow, swarthy and bearded like a gigantic Spaniard, said in a rumbling bass, "There's no one left forward, sir. I had a look round. He ain't aboard, but he may turn up before daylight." "Aye, he may or he may not," commented the mate. "Can't make out the last name. It's all a smudge." "That will do, men. Go below." The distinct and motionless group stirred, broke up, and began to move forward. "Wait!" called a deep, ringing voice. All stood still. Mr. Baker, who had turned away yawning, spun round open-mouthed. At last, furious, he blurted out, "What's this? Who said wait? What?" But he saw a tall figure standing on the rail. It came down and pushed through the crowd, marching with a heavy tread towards the light on the quarter-deck. Then again the sonorous voice said with insistence, "Wait!" The lamplight lit up the man's body. He was tall. His head was away up in the shadows of lifeboats that stood on skids above the deck. The whites of his eyes and his teeth gleamed distinctly, but the face was indistinguishable.